Yeah, I can tell some stories like that. where it's happened with that same sort of Malcolm McLaren. Mm. I wanted this part probably shouldn't be. Oh, we'll tell it later. We'll tell it. Okay. Glad to be here.
Glad to have you. It's been we tried this a few times, I think, and never quite.
I remember like when in Toronto, yeah, having a race to the airport, like at the time you were sitting down with Christine.
And when we ended up sitting near a bus station where the entire interview is unhearable because it was so loud, it was really a fabulous interview. She was great, except for the fact that you couldn't hear her.
Yeah.
Except through some sort of, if you spoke another language or something, another alien language. In any case, well, we finally got together. You've changed jobs 7 times since then.
The job of producer is always to have many things.
Forever shifting.
Yeah.
Well, Fandor seems a little more permanent. You have a big title and everything.
Yeah. No, I'm totally excited.
What is it that drove, why Fandor?
So, there's no short story with me, right? So I'm going to take us back.
Okay.
Before I moved out to the West Coast, to San Francisco, mm-hmm, I'd had a 3-year plan. And I was making 5 films, budget agnostic, the last 5 films that I made.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, I have an app I want to build. I have a big business plan. I want to build a global digital studio that is artist service based instead of rights acquisition based, right?
Mm.
It's going to take me a little while. And meanwhile, I'll be doing these movies and I'll work on my speaking tour. Mm-hmm. And maybe I'll write a book, right? That was like the thought. So I did those movies. Because the budgets were low, my fees were low. Because my fees were low, I couldn't produce full time. Because I wasn't producing full time, my emotional satisfaction in the projects were less than they could have been otherwise. Because the budgets were low, they had less marketing money behind them too, and they had less cultural impact. I finished them. I was pleased with the movies. Mm-hmm. I thought they were good movies, added to the cultural conversation. But the things that I can value, my bank account, my emotional satisfaction, mm-hmm, the impact I have in the world, were all less than I wanted to be. And I was like, this doesn't work. And you know what? My hope that everything would change over these 3 years, things haven't changed. Mm-hmm. We're still in that path of evolution. And at that time, I was very much thinking about, you know, so how will this new technology, all of it, influence what we do? You know, I benefited from a couple of things along the way by experimenting with new tools as they came along, mm-hmm, and always kind of looking at a different way of doing things. So, in going back in time, like I said, there's no short answers. Mm-hmm. Going back in time, because I utilized new technology with one film, mm-hmm, we cut the first feature ever on an Avid, narrative feature. But at that time when we did it, the pixels were like golf balls, right?
Yeah.
We ran out of time. The day we got the print, end of the line, we had to get it off to the Berlin Film Festival.
Mm-hmm.
We got into the Berlin Film Festival. I snuck the print to the sales agents I work with. You're the first to see it. Don't tell anyone. All 3 sales agents who were the first to see it all passed on it.
Mm.
They looked at it and they said, you made a completely uncommercial film, Ted. You made a film that was gay, that was Chinese, and felt like a film from the 40s. Except it was gay and Chinese. It will have no market. So when we arrived in Berlin, not having seen the print yet, watching it on the big screen, mm-hmm, seeing 8 out of focus shots because the pixels were too big to judge correctly, I was like, oh my God, when this movie's over, they're gonna hit me with tomatoes, I'm gonna be booed. And it was a press screening. And when the film ended, the press stood up and got on their chairs, mm-hmm, and applauded on their chairs. It was Ang Lee's film, The Wedding Banquet. It won the Grand Jury Prize. But because everyone had passed on that movie, mm-hmm, James Seamus, my business partner, and I had to sell it ourselves, right? $700,000 budget. We did $3 million in sales that week right? Out of our backpacks in hotel rooms and bars. We charge 10% sales fee to our investors. Mm-hmm. They got to keep an extra 20%, $600,000, than they would have lost had one of the people who knew so much taken on the film. We had enough to run our company. And I saw, like, holy crap, this is the business of film. And from then, I tried to start to kind of recognize that the art, the artists, the technology, mm-hmm. I think change much faster than the business or the marketplace, right? At that time, Harvey Weinstein was doing territorial-based foreign sales mm-hmm. on the promise of North American distribution. New Line had output deals, but weren't kind of able to cherry-pick the distributors. I looked around, and I saw this smart guy, David Lindy, you know, who was number two at Miramax. Mm-hmm. I badgered him for 2 years, saying, I'll give you a third of my company if you'll come and do this and run it up. He finally relented. We built Good Machine. We were able to do about 45 films through Good Machine, mm-hmm. financing them without having any money, right? Because it had shifted and we got a foot in the door, you know, first. Mm-hmm. And I think we're at the same place right now. Mm. Art, artists, technology have moved faster than the legacy ways that we're doing business. You see it here right now at the Toronto Film Festival. Mm-hmm. I sit with, okay, not the top tier sales agents, the next tier, and they just say, why are we here, right? No one's licensing the films mm-hmm. for 3 more months, you know, it's not gonna happen.
Right.
The meetings I get are my Greek distributor coming and saying, because you released my film in the UK first, it was bootlegged mm-hmm. and subtitled within 24 hours, and I couldn't release it.
Right.
Maybe that's not true. Maybe they're just starting to, you know, haggle in one way or the other. But we see that. And so I was feeling, you know, from where I sat, that I had to get where the action was. Mm-hmm. The reason I got to work with all these great directors, the reason our movies were, frankly, I think, quite damn good, was we were part of a community and part of a scene that was competitive with each other, that lifted the conversation up higher. New York, late 80s, early 90s, you know, mm-hmm. made it better for everybody. Something's happening out in the Bay Area. With technology, with investment, with the place where media and technology, you know, converse. Mm-hmm. I was like, I want to get there. So first, you know, when the Film Society called me, I was like, it was already a mark on my, you know, map that I had to go there. I thought you could use a nonprofit as an incubator or an mm-hmm. accelerator. They told me they could, but like anything else, they love what they do well. Yeah. They want to keep doing what they do well. Why change unless the pain of the present is greater than one's fear of right. the future? That wasn't going to happen. But while I was there, I got to know the Fandor team, the Fandor investor. When I told what I wanted to build and that an SVOD platform dedicated to creating a global community of film lovers and makers, you know, creating the brand for cinephiles was what they wanted to do too. It was like, okay, let's use that as the foundation. You know, like you can see how access mm-hmm. to the great cinema of all time can work for all the different stakeholders, you know, festivals, universities, filmmakers, exhibitors, you know, to basically get rid of some of that friction, to keep people engaged, to lift the conversation, to provide the context that is often missing from the conversation. So that's the short answer.
So does Fandor become more than Fandor is now, or something different than Fandor is now?
I think that you know, you look at what online cinema is, and mm-hmm. you know, for all the tremendous success of Netflix and Amazon and Hulu, you know, mm-hmm. I love it. Great access to everything. Mm-hmm. But they're built during a different time, frankly, when memory and bandwidth were actually quite expensive, you know, and they succeeded, mm-hmm. right? But they could only deliver a type of product that was about breadth, access to everything,
right?
Right? Fandor will become a place where you take these beautiful jewels of cinema, hand-picked gems, you provide the proper context, and with that, you get community. Mm. I want to see that promise, you know, that goes from the original birth of the web, access to everything,
right,
to Web 2.0, access to everybody, and see where content and community come together. Because for me, the cinematic experience begins before a movie starts and goes way after.
Right.
As much as I love watching movies and as much as I love making movies, frankly, I love talking about movies with people who are passionate about cinema even more, and that's part of movies. Mm. That's what Fandor will become.
So still an acquisitions company, in part, yeah, or it'll still acquire content as opposed to creating its own.
What I love about Fandor, as opposed to, say, some of these other sites, is we're not selling just entertainment. Right, that the way that you currently sell cinema online generally, right, is it's all exchangeable. You know, it's just put the slider and find something else. Mm. It's not title based, it's not artist based, it's not community based. You know, that is what Fandor is. And I think for the health of the business, we need to actually still stay focused on titles and artists, build that deeper understanding, keep that conversation going. You know, that said, acquisitions, you know, being someone who likes semantics and nuances, often refers to single title work. Mm-hmm. You know, a lot of what we do is more licensing multiple titles from distributors or from filmmakers' own catalogs. Mm-hmm. You know, but I think that building that context is what we're really about. We're, you know, it's not just streaming titles on a subscription basis. There's four blogs, mm-hmm, that all, you know, work in unison. You know, we will be integrating a lot of the what used to be called video extras, you know, right, in and around that material. You know, I think it's inevitable for any online platforms to move into original content. It's certainly my, you know, first love in the film space. Mm-hmm. There are many conversations that we've had where, you know, whether it's foundations, you know, coming to me and looking at the filmmakers we have on site, say, well, would you be interested in making a series of short films about this subject matter with that group and hosting them on your platform? We'll see some of that stuff start to come to be. Mm-hmm. On top of that, you know, I think that Fandor's, the same people that love independent film, that love foreign film, that put a lot of money into it despite the business proposition of the moment, which isn't, mm-hmm, very good, you know, will look at Fandor, you know, when we do our raises, mm-hmm, recognize the business of it is actually much better than individual projects. But once they're involved in that, they're generally in it because they love cinema and they want to advance it. Mm-hmm. The pressure, I imagine, to produce and premiere original content, you know, will arise for us. Right now, we can enjoy the fact that we don't have to do it. I'm not missing. You know, I'm finishing my wife's documentary. I have a film that Christine Vachon's producing that I developed. Mm. It's going forward. I'm not missing the day-to-day and the aggravation and that constant downward pressure to constrain instead of to expand. Mm. You know, that I've always thought of producing as engineering serendipity. How do I make sure that when that miraculous thing happens, or the sun hits that building, or whatever, that I can change my schedule to allow for us to get that? Mm-hmm. And as the downward pressure of budgets come, your ability to do that gets less and less and less and less and less. You know, mm-hmm, it's not, you know, like it's an interesting time. You know, very much the best of times, the worst of times. You know, never cheaper to make a movie. Never before could you work at such a small, intimate level. Mm-hmm. Never before was it so hard to earn a good living, you know, making exceptional work.
So you have a heavy presence on the web, and you have your book, Hope for Film, which is out there now. So you're having this. You're having this conversation. Hopefully, not into a dark alley. People seem to be participating and wanting to participate in the conversation with you. Is there an answer as to where you are? Is there? I mean, obviously, is it or is it just the best and worst of times? Is that just the only answer that's realistic at this point?
Well, one of the things I'm most excited about that I think defines this year, right? Like the thing we hit this year, is I think that for the first time ever, we actually have the capacity to manage the complexity of what a systems rebuild of the entire film ecosystem could be. In that, I've always thought of producing as managing complexity, right? You know, but we've had the benefit of 120 years of defining the process, finding best practices, documenting that, a level of transparency that came with the American independent, rise. We teach each other how to make movies better. And I think the movies do improve. We haven't been able to do that through all the different stakeholders and enterprises that exist, you know, in the filmic ecosystem. But I feel it's pretty much documented now, whether it's at the festival level, at the university level, at press and media, creation, finance. Like, a lot of things have been said, and we can gather them and start to weigh the repercussions for different stakeholders, see where their needs are, and see how these mutual benefits can start to come. I've tried to map that out myself. I know I have gaps, but I can picture being in a room with 25 other people who feel like I do about this, who've thought about aspects of it, like yourself, and together we could start to weigh it. Now, we're not gonna solve it, but you could say, you know, this organization, Sundance, or this organization, IFP, or maybe the MPAA, you know, we're gonna take on these different sorts of things and keep each other informed, listen to the nuance, and, you know, the rising tide will lift all boats. You know, I think we just hit that point where we can do that. And to me, that's really exciting.
And do you think people who are financing movies are wanting to do that?
It's kind of curious. I'm going to go out to the Sundance Catalyst weekend. You know, Sundance launched that last year. So essentially, that's financier training program. Right? We were working on something very similarly at the San Francisco Film Society when I was there. You see the start of kind of the incubator accelerator approach, you know, in the film world, kind of filtered down from you know, venture capital. You start to see deeper analysis on the web of the financial waterfall, you know, of it. I think you see investors starting to try to take a more business-minded approach. I mean, let's be serious, really. Most films get financed because people want to be photographed next to a movie star. That's still like the number one sell. Number two sell, we're going to take your movie to Toronto, 2015, Sundance, Cannes, Berlin, Venice, all those things. But at the same time, usually these people have made money in some other field. They don't want to look foolish. They want to have a serious approach to film. So you see new investors talking about things like a portfolio approach, small bets. You know, how do we have a sustainable investment community? You know, typically speaking, most investors, independent, you know, private equity investors, are in movies two times, win or lose. That's it. You know, they recognize it's too arbitrary.
Right.
But I think at the same time, you'll start to see folks saying, "Wait a second, if I care about culture creation, I also have to make sure that there are direct ways to reach the consumer with this product in some ways. And so you start to see the same people who are investing in my movies ask me like when we're going to start our Series A round at Fandor. You know, so I think that yes, there is a growing breed in the investment community who are looking at how do we have a better, more sustainable model. Are we there yet? Give it some time. You know.
Well, I'm always curious about the idea of there being a model that any model that works. It's, you know, that isn't driven by the actual market to wherever it is. I mean, it's as the markets have changed over the last 30, 40 years, it's had a lot to do with how technology has changed and where the revenues are coming from. And the scary part for independents right now, I think, is that the foreign market is not open to them. So they're left with very little, you know, a very small slice of the domestic theatrical market.
Yeah.
And very little DVD comparatively to a few years ago. And, you know, now the VOD thing, which I think is a little destructive in some ways. I mean, I think it's very positive for a certain percentage of the movies, but it's also, I believe strongly in the glass ceiling theory of it, that, you know, there's no up, you know, and I think that we saw that this summer where we saw three movies that did, you know, over $10 million, none of which had VOD business, VOD attached early on, early VOD, or day and date VOD, and, you know, I think we saw the results of that, is that the audience is paying attention more than I think we realize, and as much as people say they want VOD, if they're gonna, they're willing to go to the movies if you ask them to go to the movies.
Yeah, I think, you know, the film business is established on an incredibly arrogant premise, right? That we can actually bring people to a product, right? The fact is, cinema in the theaters, it is more than just watching a movie, right? It's getting out of the house. It's having glorious sound. San Francisco has a couple of beautiful theaters right now that are a delight to arrive early and have a drink and sit back in a chair that leans back where you're only sitting next to your wife, not like thousands of other people. Their chairs are nicely done. It's a nice experience, right? I think that the title business, drive a person online, on cable, to a single title, you know, that there's little awareness on, is really a difficult premise, right? It's not a great experience. You know, you're distracted because the life at home is the way it is, and you don't know too much about that. But the idea of how we build a network effect in a community, in a social cinema experience, of what that nature of online can be, is a different beast, right? That if you are drawn to ambitious cinema, to transformative cinema, to films, the way culture, society is built by ongoing conversations across time and location, you have to be able to take risks. You can't just drop $10, $5, $3, $2, one, whatever it is. You want to be able to sample different sorts of things and not just have experiences, engage in conversation, discover people, artists, as well as films. You know, sometimes, you know, it's interesting to watch, you know, like online cinema from where I sit gives you all sorts of different types of statistics, like where you see films that, oh, this film often stops at 10 minutes, but people return to it within 2 weeks' time. Right? There's enough engagement where you go in, okay, I've watched 5 minutes, I like this, I don't have 90 minutes right now, right? Same time, you see things like short form documentary is one of our most popular top 10 genres on Fandor. People love to come in, watch something quick, leave with a greater awareness or understanding of something, and they'll settle down to watch something else later.
Right.
Right. That Fandor is one of the only places where you get that mix of short form work, long form work, experimental, cult, you know, narrative doc, international, American, science, you know, all of that. For me as a film lover, you know, that's kind of incredible. But we haven't done well as a business too. So if, you know, well, to tie that one up, mm-hmm. I almost got lost there. You know, so we expect people to come to titles.
Right.
What Fandor is, it's a community. You mm-hmm. want to bring work where people are already gathered. What, you know, we're about the love of cinema, right. But you have things where things are about social justice or women's issues or a particular demographic. How we bring work to those communities, I think, mm-hmm. speaks a lot of the future of cinema, you know.
And is it, is there a financial side of it that actually seems to make sense? I mean, you kind of wonder how many $8 subscriptions, you know, monthly subscriptions people are willing to line up.
It's an interesting question, right? So, historically speaking, because I know you're good with the statistics and math and following that. Historically speaking, right, the specialized audience has only been about 3%, a little mm-hmm. bit less, of the domestic box office, except for those weird years where, you know, Fahrenheit 9/11 and right. Passion of the Christ both come out, right? Yep. And you get a big blimp. 3%. There are 115 million television homes in America, mm-hmm. right? That's 3% of that's a pretty nice number, right?
Yeah.
Let's say we have 1 million subscribers. I think that's an achievable number. Mm-hmm. $10 a month at Fandor. For you, I'll give you a discount. for your readers, I'll give you a discount. But or viewers. But $10 a month, let's say $100 a year, right? Fandor committed, you know, to preserving film culture, right. Committed to the filmmakers and the artists. We give half of our subscription revenue back to the films, right?
Mm-hmm.
So $100 million from 1 million subscribers,
right?
Split that in half, $50 million back to the movies. 5,000 films on the platform.
Mm-hmm.
80-20 rule, right? 20% of the titles drive 80% of the views. So 1,000 titles,
right.
$40 million. But you can cut that a few more times, right?
Mm-hmm.
So 200 titles, $32 million.
Mm-hmm.
40 titles, $24 million. What is that? 730,000, you know, right. That's a lot more money going back to specialized films.
Yes.
But it doesn't mean like that's where it ends. It means like you can say, okay, if we're going to have those 40 titles hit that, that means we have 150 titles that we expect to give $50,000 back.
Right.
Now, we're not there yet. But I tell you, like, if you love cinema,
mm-hmm.
if you care about cinema culture, you want to become a member of Fandor, you want to make sure we get to that 1 million subscribers, because then it starts to work. It works for everybody. We'll be able to access that, you know, Georgian film that you right. wanted to see that's not going to get a theatrical release. We just had, for me, it's a really exciting thing happen. A filmmaker whose film was on the platform. We have a festival initiative where, mm-hmm. where, you know, we promote festivals,
mm-hmm.
we give them tools, we help them raise money for their festivals.
Mm-hmm.
Santa Fe Independent Film Festival saw this filmmaker's work on Fandor mm-hmm. and put it into their program.
Huh.
Right? That's a nice little shift.
Yeah.
When you start to think, okay, we have a community, let's say you're releasing 12 Years a Slave this year,
mm-hmm.
right? And you want to access the most passionate, influential people in African American art film, right?
Mm-hmm.
So you do your comps,
mm-hmm.
you choose which those movies are, and you find 1,000 people. Well, I can connect you with them. I know, you know,
right.
You find those folks, so then you send them a message, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Next Thursday, online, we'll give you an exclusive look at this new movie in exchange for you filling out a questionnaire of 5 questions, right?
Mm-hmm.
So at that point, you know, you the producer say, okay, so we just surveyed 1,000 people across the country. You know, we left out New York and LA because mm-hmm. we know they love these films already, but we did the quote flyover states,
right.
And we found those people, and 85% of them scored the top 2 boxes that mm-hmm. they definitely recommended to their friends. And you know what? These 1,000 people have a social graph each averaging 550 people, right? That starts to change things. Mm-hmm. I think we're going to start to see where you use kind of that targeted approach to reach people online, to demonstrate the necessity of a theatrical opening in some level, you know? You know, ultimately, I just think that, we haven't yet even begun to utilize, all of us in
the film industry,
you know, the tools that we have immediately available right now for us that have already been built.
Well, I think the question is always conversion. You know, that's the issue certainly with Twitter and with other things. It's like, and it just hasn't proven to be the case yet, but it seems like this is, you know, you've got a legitimate philosophy in terms of trying to make it happen. And the question is whether people will, you know, whether that million people will turn up and spend $100 a year.
Right. Well, it gets reductive, you know, down to that. I think that there are other things that are kind of interesting, you know, how we utilize it. Mm-hmm. You know, I go back to my lesson on super, right? I feel good. I feel like I helped give America its favorite movie this year, right?
You know?
Because 3 years ago or something, we came to Toronto with James Gunn's Super, opening night at Midnight Madness. We were coming off of, I think, 2 years of terrible sales, you know. We were the first sale of Toronto that year. I think there were like 29 titles sold that year. It was a good year.
Yeah.
We had estimated zero for North America. You know, IFC bought U.S. and Canada, $1 million, right? Now, why did they buy it? Great audience response. Toronto's an incredible audience, particularly the Midnight Madness audience. Fantastic, you know, very exuberant. But we had an engaged populace because we had asked our entire group to tweet during the course of that. Now, not tons of followers, right?
Right.
Didn't lead to ticket sales, absolutely, but the industry, the audience I had to sell to first, was engaged in that conversation, highly aware. They saw the response here, and we were able to convert that, you know, and they weren't the only ones. We had multiple, you know, folks bidding for the film.
Right.
So, end of the day, yes, I was disappointed in the ticket sales for Super. Was I ecstatic 36 hours or 24 hours after the screening of Super? Absolutely, because we did a sale. Am I ecstatic that James Gunn got a chance to show who he really was as a director? You know, to push things a little bit further with that film and to give Marvel the confidence that he could go out and make a movie like Guardians of the Galaxy? Absolutely. You know, so yes, I want to have 1 million subscribers on Fandor, 1 million people passionately engaged in the conversation around cinema. Will they all come in that fashion of one new subscriber at a time? Will perhaps some university say, wait a second, we want a way that our students can legally access cinema, and we're not training them to you know, download on BitTorrents, you know, anymore? Will film societies say, wait a second, we want to find a way to program to our community on a year-round basis, you know, not at the overhead of having a theatrical program, but we already know that 50 films from our festival back catalog already available on Fandor, and we actually have the Q&As that go with those films. I think you'll start to see many different models, you know, start to come forward. I don't need 1 million subscribers to survive, you know, to it, but I'd like to be able to have a big impact on the industry so that the type of cinema that I wanted to make, the type of cinema I got to make for 15 plus years, films that were part of the historic conversation, that pushed the envelope in subject matter or style, where I got to take risks on new directors, on voices that weren't given room to talk about before. Do I want to make those type of movies? Absolutely. And I think that the opportunity, because of the direct address between community, you know, online, and the content, is there in an incredible way. You know, we can change the second big problem in the industry. If the first one was this arrogant belief that people come to see things, we've done such a horrible job of matching people with the films that they're most likely to love, right? Like each new film, still, it's like, you know, standing out on this porch yelling to Toronto, hey, come see my movie, come see my movie. It's about effect, that's how we market our movies, as opposed to saying, I know that you loved Killer of Sheep, I know that you loved Daughters of the Dust, you know, and you're gonna love 12 Years a Slave. You know, like, that information is now available, people broadcast it, let's use it.
Makes sense. But you have to be satisfied with smaller bites. I mean, I think that's the biggest thing, is that it's such a business of ambition and such a, you know, thing about everyone wants to have the big hit and everything else, but you have to kind of be willing to hit singles and doubles and not complain till, you know, eventually you'll hit a triple, maybe you'll hit a home run, but, you know, it sounds like a singles and doubles business.
I think, often I complain about this culture of abundance. And I was in conversation with Ruby Lerner, who runs Creative Capital, which is a nonprofit that gives money to artists across their lifespan, really. And she said, yeah, culture of abundance, but now we're also able to address the niches on a grand scale, right? That many people can talk to these specific targeted audiences. And the success that we had at Good Machine was always about underserved audiences, you know, addressing those, and they were just the core demographic. But when you think about how movies do such a great job keeping a community glued together, you know, they can be much smaller communities, I believe, that will be much more passionately engaged around the work that is most appropriate for them. They'll have much greater inclination, hopefully, to proselytize, amplify, send that ripple out. Eventually, you know, you see things like, man, my faith in cinema, my enthusiasm was restored when I went to Telluride and saw Birdman, right? Now, I think Alfonso is, Inarritu is one of the great filmmakers of our moment. When I saw Morris Perros, I was like, that's who I want to work with. I have this in my book, like it was at a moment where I was feeling, okay, a little jaded, a little depressed. I was like, there's not a director I want to work with. And I saw Morris Perros, and I was like, oh my God, I'll never work with him. He's a Mexican director, I'll never meet him. I was like, the next day my phone rang. And it was him, and Alfonso Cuarón had given him my number. Alejandro was looking for a producer. It took another 2 weeks for us to connect, but I ended up working with him on 21 Grams. But it was a serious guy dealing with weighty issues, right? Incredible showman, great cinema, right? But dark tales, right? Birdman is a delight, right? Yes, it's still heavy issues, but it's incredibly fun, right? And you see that mastery at, one of the best films of the decade, you know? And I think that because of everyone's exposure now, of the ability to access not just features, but shorts, commercials across time, experimental film, you know, silent movies, every sorts of, you know, film from around the globe. This next wave of filmmakers, you know, if you look at and say, okay, Quentin Tarantino is the master of the video clerk cinema. We haven't yet seen the master of the online cinema. Someone that's able to work beyond the feature format, who looks at the continuum of their work, experiments across platforms, delivering cinema, showmanship, across all those platforms. The excitement that I felt in Telluride seeing Alejandro's movie, I'm confident I'm going to find online in a different way, maybe not feature film format, in the next 6 months, right? I think there's incredible hope for film.
Perfect tag. Thank you so much. Pleasure.